Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Ruby Bradley. Ruby as in the gemstone, and Bradley as in the strapping young man, so handsome. Anyway, I'm Ruby Bradley, that's easy enough to remember. Now, here's a story all about how my life got twisted upside down, and if you'd like to take a moment and sit for me, I'll tell you how I became one of the most decorated women in U.S. military history. So my story begins when I was a young school teacher in West Virginia.
Almost heaven, West Virginia.
A school teacher was one of few jobs open to women at the time. I enjoyed caring for the children, but I wanted more. I knew I needed to expand my cultural competence. My younger sister Sally was a nurse, and upon visiting my sister's ward, I discovered a new and exciting world. It was 1930, in the midst of the Depression, so jobs were scarce. I was not discouraged and got into nursing school in Philadelphia in that same year. I graduated 3 years later. In hopes of adventure, I took the oath to join the Army Nurses Corps. For 6 years, I worked at Walter Reed Hospital in Maryland. Then, the fateful day came that I opened my orders that would send me to the Philippines for a 2-year tour of duty. We boarded a ship to Mandalay Bay in the Philippines. Once we got there, I felt like I was living in a paradise. I began working in the OR as a surgical nurse. I enjoyed taking care of patients, and I enjoyed life. Then, on December 7, 1941, the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. The facts of yesterday and today speak for themselves. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God.
A Philadelphia surgeon named Dr. Ravidin was flown into Hawaii to examine the burn victims. He brought with him albumin, a new substance separated from plasma and developed by a professor at Harvard University. The albumin was administered to severely burned patients and saved their lives. The war effort inspired many advances in medicine, including plasma banks and blood preservation techniques. Volunteers in New York City began donating blood for wounded soldiers overseas. In the following years, Dr. Edward Churchill would educate the army leaders to treat hemorrhagic shock with blood instead of plasma. And I could never forget mentioning the wonder drug, penicillin. Its effectiveness couldn't have been proven at as crucial time as this. Now back to my story. Little did we know that a couple weeks after the attack on Pearl Harbor, the military base I was stationed at would be attacked by Japanese forces as well. Meanwhile, President Roosevelt's focus was on defeating Nazi forces in Europe, so any hope of rescue would have to wait. Once captured, we were held in filthy, unsanitary barracks that did not in any way meet my nursing standards. It was a breeding ground for disease, body fluids were everywhere, and dysentery was on the rise. So I taught everyone how to keep clean, scrub the floors, and the importance of hand washing. Much to my surprise, the Japanese gave me permission to establish a small hospital. It is a mystery, but somehow I managed to be transferred to the Santo Tomas internment camp where I knew I was needed. The conditions at the camp were dismal, though. Food was in very short supply, so I did all I could to get food, which included hiding eggs in my uniform to give to the children, as well as giving them my own food ration. After 3 years, 230 surgeries, and 13 baby deliveries later, the Americans arrived and stormed Santo Tomas, overtaking the Japanese. The year was 1945. On that very same day, I stood among my fellow soldiers, singing the Star Spangled Banner as the American flag was raised. A few months later, we were brought back to America. It was a glorious home. Upon my return, I was promoted to captain and continued to work in different hospitals as a charge nurse. Then, in 1950, the Korean War began and knew my service would be greatly needed overseas. With much courage, I requested duty in Korea. I was chief nurse at the 171st Evacuation Hospital in Korea and was soon promoted to major. In 1953, ceasefire between the Koreans was reached. Upon my return from Korea, I was promoted to colonel and rewarded the Legion of Merit. I am known to be the most decorated woman in the U.S. military at the time. I continued to work as chief nurse in a variety of settings in the U.S. and abroad. One of the most salient memories I have of this time is of a prissy little lieutenant who was begging for a dose of Nurse Ruby's special medicine.
Captain, we have a complaint. In our last duty assignment, we worked 4-hour day shifts and 6-hour night shifts. We feel that the 8-hour shifts you require are too much.
You listen to me, Lieutenant. I have watched nurses who existed on a cup of rice a day work 14 to 18 hour shifts. No one complained. Operating rooms ran 24 hours a day under the most primitive conditions. No one complained. I have seen nurses so weak that they had to stop and rest between patients. No one complained. No wonder thousands of wounded men they saved have called them angels in fatigue. It is my fervent hope that you never experience what these women did.
I retired in 1963 at the age of 63. Content with the life of adventure and service I had led, I died in 2003 at the age of 103 and was buried in Arlington National Cemetery. I will forever live on as an angel in fatigue, inspiring all of you young nurses who hear my story.